WMPG, Gorham, Portland. Hi, Golden Age film fanatics, and welcome to DVD Classics Corner on the Air. My name is Dick Dinman, and our goal is to become your exclusive guide to the very best of the Golden Age classics coming out on DVD. We'll have reviews, breaking news of upcoming releases, plenty of surprise guests, and a special feature devoted to the great Golden Age film composers, which we call Cine Music. So let's turn on the marquee and lights... Camera, action. It's time for Dick's Picks, in which I get to shine the spotlight on one of my Dick's Picks of the week. Twilight Time proudly announces their stunning limited edition Blu-ray release of Jules Verne's classic adventure tale that captured the imagination of cinema goers as few films had done before. The one, the only, the original, The Journey to the Center of the Earth. Braving exploding volcanoes, tumbling rock slides, and flesh-eating reptiles, James Mason co-stars along with my two treasured guests today, Arlene Dahl and song and screen icon Pat Boone, in a phantasmagoric thrill ride of an adventure that's certain to keep you on the edge of your seat.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is James Mason. Come along with Pat Boone and me, Arlene Dahl, Diane Baker, and Gertrude the Duck, and discover sights and sounds and wonders no living man has ever witnessed before, filmed in the incomparable magic of CinemaScope. We'll take our leave of civilization on the bleak, barren wastes of Iceland, peer in awe at the bottomless crater of an uncharted volcano, make the perilous descent into the unknown. You'll pioneer with us through countless miles of trackless labyrinths, discover huge subterranean caverns never beheld by human eye, become lost in the weird underground maze. You'll find yourself engulfed in grotesque, petrified jungles, marvel at the fantastically beautiful quartz grotto, tumble into cascading salt beds, escape from hissing steam caves, behold the staggering underground ocean. You'll encounter breathtaking dangers beyond belief, here at the center of the Earth.
Twilight Time's The Journey to the Center of the Earth, in the wonder of super high-def Blu-ray and the magic of 4.0 DTS HD sound, is being released in a limited 3,000 units. Once they're gone, they are gone. And is available exclusively online at screenarchives.com, even as we speak. Stay tuned for more Dick's Picks, coming up on DVD Classics Corner on the Air very soon. My first guest is the magnificent Arlene Dahl, Journey to the Center of the Earth's female lead, who through the years in countless film starring roles has proven once and forever that both incomparable physical beauty and great talent can coexist happily in one irresistible package. Jules Verne's Journey to the Center of the Earth.
Yes.
And originally, I don't know whether you're aware of this, Clifton Webb was supposed to play the James Mason part, but had a heart attack or something, and James Mason replaced him.
I think his mother, Maybell, had a heart attack.
Oh, is that...
And they were very close, and of course I knew Clifton socially as well. So that was probably why.
I
he
see.
Just wanted to be with her and didn't
well,
want
I...
to have to give it up, you know, be on the set every day. I think when James Mason was cast in the part, and heard that I was going to play opposite him, he wasn't happy about that at all.
Why?
Well, I don't know, but this was the scuttlebutt that he was not pleased with me. The director was fine. The producers, who were friends of mine as well, were fine. And this was under a deal that my agent had made earlier. But the first scene that I did with James, he sort of softened a little bit because he was very gruff and very beady-eyed.
Really?
Oh, I felt very uncomfortable on the set until we had our first scene.
Put me down. Put me down. Big odds. Kindly put me down. Put me down. Somebody please explain this outrage. Are we to be abducted every day in Iceland?
Viltu reina outvega mer fjallkungusko.
Ja, madam.
Strax. Tusen takk.
She speaks Icelandic.
I do. But I wish to apologize to you in plain English. I went through my husband's diary, and some of his remarks led me to believe you. I did you an injustice. I'm sorry, I didn't know.
Don't give it another thought. I shan't.
I'm Sir Oliver's assistant. My name is Alec McEwen.
As a matter of fact, this whole expedition began thanks to this lad. Began, and that's all it has done.
Sir Oliver, this morning you asked me for these. If you still want them, they're yours.
Will you say that again?
I shall not stand in the way of the Lindenbrook expedition.
Oh, madam.
My husband had these boots made specially. I hope they fit you.
Uh-huh.
Mine will be ready without delay. I told your man to order some for me immediately.
Good, good. What was that? Why would you need boots like this?
Well, I can't very well go in these.
Go where, madam?
Don't say it.
Well, naturally, I'm coming along. That's why I'm giving you all of this. That's a condition. I thought you understood.
You didn't mention any condition.
Then I do now. Whom did you intend to take along besides this young man?
The big Icelander.
Then I'll be very useful. He doesn't understand a word of English.
You can't come along. You're a woman.
And what has my sex to do with it?
Well, we're not contemplating a stroll down Piccadilly or the Champs-Élysées.
Professor Lindenbrook, I have just lost my husband. I have nothing else to live for anymore up here. Down there, I can at least represent his name.
Fortunately, the decision is not yours to make. The police will require your presence for the investigation into your husband's death.
I have already given my testimony.
But, madam, quite apart from the appalling danger, think of the inconvenience.
The lack of privacy.
In short, you don't want all of this, is that it?
I may be mad on the subject of this journey, but I am not stupid. To burden myself with a female is sheer stupidity.
I resent that word. I may have been a disturbance to men, never a burden.
This is an absolute hold-up. I assure you, you will not receive one iota of extra consideration. You'll sleep where we sleep, you'll eat what we eat, and you'll wash when we wash.
Then you accept my proposition.
Oh.
And then he came over to me after the second or third scene we had together. He said, Miss Dahl. He never called me Arlene. Miss Dahl? I said, yes, Mr. Mason. You're okay. That was a big compliment from James. You're okay.
How was it then for the rest of the film?
He softened even. He mellowed. He mellowed. And we were on location for 3 months in Carlsbad Cavern. I had just given birth to Lorenzo, and who was being looked after by a baby nurse. And so I was... off the set, I was calling, you know, L.A. to find out how my three-month-old child was. It took a long time to complete that, and of course, I had a Scandinavian accent. I was talking up and down and up and down, because she was a Swedish widow. And Pat Boone, who was in it, had a Swedish, had a Scottish burr, and James was English, and the Icelandic man didn't speak English at all, only Icelandic, so... the big wigs at 20th Century Fox, Daryl Zanuck, in fact, said, who's going to understand any of these people? Who are the American audience is going to identify with? So we all had to go back after 3 months in Carlsbad Caverns, New Mexico, working under, you can't imagine the conditions, stalactites and stalagmites and so on. We had to go back to the soundstage, and we had to dub the entire film with a softer accent on well, James, of course, never softened at all, but Pat practically lost his Scottish fur, and I couldn't talk up and down and up and down like that. I could just have a little bit of an inkling of a Swedish accent.
And as it is, the film turned out to be 20th Century Fox's biggest financial success of the year.
Yes.
It was a hugely, hugely popular film.
And the music was so haunting.
Bernard Herrmann.
Yes.
Oh, it is one of the great scores of all time.
Yes, and it was up for many Academy nominations.
As it should have been. This is a film where the score really contributed. It was really incredible.
Station identification.
DVD Classics Corner on the Air is proud to be a presentation of Southern Maine's own WMPG FM 90.9 and 104.1 on your dial. And that, of course, is the unmistakably melodic voice of once-in-a-lifetime song and screen icon Pat Boone, who I'm honored to have as my next guest as he shares the triumphs, trials, and tribulations of his starring role in The Journey to the Center of the Earth. Pat Boone, welcome to DVD Classics Corner on the Air. I've so long wanted to have you as a guest, and we have the perfect occasion for this this great get-together, which is the Blu-ray release of the sci-fi classic Journey to the Center of the Earth, courtesy of Twilight Time. I've seen it. It looks as great as it looked when I first saw it in a revival house in New York City, in a very good print. And
good.
This looks it looks even better.
Well, I wish I could say I had seen it. I have copies, but I just hadn't found the time yet to look at it because I didn't want to just put it on and look at it for 10 minutes and then have to go milk the cows or something. So, so I'm waiting to see it, but I'm glad to get that report, especially from you, because you see these things and you can tell the difference.
Well, I hope you have a good sound system, because I have to tell you, Journey to the Center of the Earth has one of the greatest film scores ever written by Bernard Herrmann.
Yep, Mr. Herrmann, yes.
And it rocks. I'm telling you, it is incredible. When those opening notes descend deeper and deeper and deeper, it is just a wonderful experience.
And you may know that when this film was produced, it was not in an era of other science fiction films. There had been one other, a Jules Verne story with Kirk Douglas.
20,000 Leagues Under the Sea.
And that was seemed like an anomaly because it was, you know, it was not, they weren't making a lot of science fiction or horror films. And if they did, they were cheap and like the cabbage that ate Cleveland or something. But that they weren't taken seriously. But this film, 20th Century Fox really believed that it was going to be a big film, and they really spared no expense. They spent a lot of money on the sets. They went on location to Carlsbad Caverns in New Mexico. We went, and then they created huge water scenes for when we get close to the and actually arrived at the center of the earth. And the music, I mean, as you say, Bernard Herrmann stinted not one bit. He had the big orchestra, the wonderful arrangements. Everything about it was first class.
It was.
And a cast that cost him a lot of money as well.
And I would venture to say that probably the finest actor you ever worked with would be James Mason.
Yeah, I think so. I can't think of an exception. There have been some really good comedic actors like Walter Matthau and Tony Curtis and Dennis O'Keefe and others. But yes, James Mason was just a consummate actor. He'd already done so many very noteworthy, famous things that I at first felt a little intimidated.
That's what I wanted to ask you.
Mm-hmm.
Did you, in fact, feel intimidated by James Mason? I must tell you that I've just had Arlene Dahl on the show, and she'll be on this same show.
Uh-huh.
And she was rather uncomfortable with James Mason because she claimed that he didn't want her in the picture. Eventually, he sort of warmed up to her, but there was a distance between them, which she found somewhat disconcerting. How did James Mason treat you? You were this huge star, singing star of movies and radio, records, television, but not in his proximate domain.
No.
How did he strike you?
First of all, he was very nice, very welcoming. I didn't get the feeling that he was in any way awed by my success. He'd had plenty of his own, and I knew I was young. And it's interesting, as you talked about his reaction to the lady, I feel that his reactions to both of us was in character. I even wonder if he, being such a good actor, not so much a method actor, that is, that his performance would alter and change and be affected by what you did in a scene. He came in ready to do what he was going to do. He'd already thought how every inflection, everything he was going to say, it was always the same. It was always right. And you could throw up, and he would still and he would still do his lines as they were written and as he had intended. But But he, I think his disdain for, and all of a sudden I've gone blank on her name. How can that be?
Arlene Dahl.
Arlene. I had Lamas in my head, and I knew that was not. was Mrs. Fernando Lamas, but it, anyway, Arlene, his disdain for her was so right for the two characters, because Professor, not Sock Newsom, I'm getting the names mixed up too.
That's anyway, understandable. It's been a few years.
Yeah, it has. Plus, I've had tons of other things on my mind lately, but anyway, the character he played was disdainful of the character that she played. And the character that he played was aware that this young kid that was going on the mission with him was just that, a young kid, and that he would have to instruct him in everything he did. He would have to be patient.
You know, that's interesting. So what you're essentially saying is that he was the kind of actor who tried to, and successfully, I imagine, stay in character even off screen.
Yeah, it seemed that way. He did have a sense of humor, and I see why she felt that that he was being a little disdainful for her, because he kidded her. I'll never forget the scene, the very climactic scene when we're on the raft, and we're getting to the center of the earth, and the big Icelander's gold tooth is pulled right out of his mouth.
Mm-hmm.
And everything metal is being sucked away because we're arriving at the center of the earth, and the sea is getting very rough. We're heading into a whirlpool. We were on a big raft about, I'd say, 8 feet off the floor. We had to get on a ladder to get up on it. That was so that it could be rotated round and round, and they had these cannons that could throw hundreds of gallons of water on us, like waves lapping over us. I mean, there was no way you could do that. No such thing as computer graphics or anything. And so, and this raft had to rock and turn and be inundated with water. It was really a rugged scene. Now, she was a strong Nordic woman, but she sometimes acted as if she was just a frail female creature. And James was, he found that funny, so he kidded her. And so now here we were on this raft, and it was so noisy that it was going to have to be overdubbed anyway.
Yeah.
So it didn't matter a whole lot what we were saying. I mean, we were supposed to be saying things like, hold on, and cry out, you know, here comes another wave or something. Meanwhile, she was pleading, crying out, get me off of here. This is terrible. I'm just, please stop this. Get me off, to the director. And James Mason was saying, quiet, woman, you'll spoil the scene. We'll have to do it 10 more times. And I was laughing. I was turning my face away from wherever I saw a camera. I was trying to put my head down like I was holding on for dear life, which I was, while the water just flooded over us, and it was a rugged scene. And as soon as it ended, Arlene had to be taken, or asked to be taken to the infirmary. And so they came and they put her on a stretcher and took her to the infirmary where she could recover from this awful beating that she'd taken. And James, as I say, was rather disdainful. He found it funny.
And I think both of us are guilty of ignoring the other female in the cast.
Oh, yes.
Gertrude the Duck.
Well, and Diane Baker, I thought you were going to say.
No, I'm talking about Gertrude the Duck.
That was Gertrude's only role, but she made the most of it.
She certainly did. She must have had a very good agent in order to...
Well, I don't know. Any role in which you're eaten alive...
That's the only problem I have. They established this and this wonderful character, and well, we've given it away. But what can you do? You know, that's the way it is now. But this was a completely different type of film from the two Fox films, or possibly three, Bernadine, April, Love. And I forgot whether Mardi Gras came before.
It was number three.
So yeah. Journey was number four. Did you have any problems about participating in the film, considering it was such a comparative departure for you?
Yeah, I did not want to do it.
Really?
I've been frank about this, because I saw myself at that time. I mean, I was young and still new to the movie business. I'd had a couple of big box office successes, but that didn't fool me into thinking I was some kind of great actor, or even that I was going to have an ongoing career in the movie business. But if I was, I saw myself as a young Bing Crosby.
Mm-hmm.
And I was looking for romantic comedies like the ones I'd already done. And they'd been successful, and I got to sing music and have hit records from the films, and was accepted, you know, and even some of the critics felt like I was doing a good job.
I hope you'll join me next week as film, radio, television, and recording legend Pat Boone joins me for part two of our DVD Classics Corner on the Air salute to the astonishing Blu-ray release of The Journey to the Center of the Earth. Well, that's my show for today. DVD Classics Corner on the Air is conceived, written, produced, and directed by me, Double D. And if you missed any part of this show, or if you'd like to hear some of my other latest shows, just go to the archive section at www.wmpg.org. And if you'd like to hear some of my older, vintage shows, please go to www.dvdclassicscorner.net, where in addition to the broadcasts, you'll find hundreds of my print reviews of classic DVD releases. So, until next week on WMPG,
keep well, keep happy, and keep listening.